A father known as Papa Merciless, an infant doubling as a human shield, and parents hiding not only crimes, but a secret sister as well. Stay tuned to learn about athletes who couldn't stand their parents. Todd Marinovich was just as much of a household name during his high school career as he was during his professional one. The California-born quarterback was profiled in Sports Illustrated back in 1988. They wrote about his talent, sure, but also focused on the intense training regimen his father had him on since he was an infant. According to Esquire, Todd's father, Marv Marinovich, studied Eastern Bloc training methods and became one of the NFL's first strength and conditioning coaches. When his son was born in 1969, the football-obsessed father had one goal, making Todd the best quarterback in football history. He started early, teaching the baby to do push-ups and stand on a balance beam before he could walk. As the younger Marinovich grew up, there was no semblance of a normal childhood, just endless practice and appointments with a team of experts. Todd's early years were so intense that Sports Illustrated dubbed him America's first test tube athlete, though his eventual professional career left much to be desired. This insane pressure eventually drove a wedge between father and son and sent Todd down a path of drug and alcohol addiction. However, the two seem to have reconciled sometime between Todd's exit from professional sports in 2001 and Marv's death in 2020. Arguably the most dominant boxer in the sport's history, Floyd Mayweather Jr. did not have an easy time of it growing up. According to stories told to the Los Angeles Times, Mayweather's mother was an unreliable drug addict, and his father, Floyd Mayweather Sr., was a former boxer and a volatile drug dealer who allegedly once used his infant son as a shield in a gunfight. Even with the aggressive and unrelenting approach Mayweather Sr. had toward his son's training, he was able to remain in his son's good graces until 2000, when Mayweather Jr. fired his dad as both his manager and trainer. According to the Bleacher Report, the dismissal was due to Mayweather Sr.'s impossible expectations of perfection and Mayweather Jr.'s desire to train with his more relaxed uncle, Roger Mayweather. After that initial spat, the father and son had an on-again, off-again relationship that almost ended for good in 2011, when an argument between them captured by HBO cameras nearly came to blows.
Our training camp is fine. We're undefeated. We've been undefeated. We're going to stay undefeated. Our training camp
is okay. You were undefeated when you started with your daddy.
However, by the time of Mayweather Jr.'s retirement in 2017, undefeated and a multimillionaire, he had reconciled with his pops. Tennis legend Andre Agassi won 8 Grand Slam titles and an Olympic gold medal during his career. But despite all his success, Andre wrote in his 2009 autobiography, Open, that he passionately hated his sport. Why? Because of his intense and often abusive father. Mike Agassi was Andre's first coach. He required his son to hit 2,500 balls a day as an elementary schooler and developed the youngster's speed in an attempt to ensure he had enough energy to play for hours on end. After leaving school as a high school freshman to turn pro, Andre became arguably the most recognizable face in tennis, despite his deep dislike of the sport. The situation led to an estrangement between father and son, and Andre dropped his father as his coach. The elder Agassi never apologized for his over-the-top antics, only admitting in an interview with an Italian-language newspaper that he was, quote, a tyrant, hard and severe. Somehow, the father and son repaired their troubled relationship and had fully reconciled before Mike's death in 2021. A tennis legend in her own right, Andre Agassi's wife, Steffi Graf, had difficulties with her own father. Peter Graf was Steffi's coach and manager and began training his daughter before she was old enough to enroll in school. When she was 3, Peter gave Steffi a sawed-off racket and began volleying balls to her over the back of the couch. Only after she hit 25 in a row would she be rewarded. His coaching style got even more extreme over the following years and took an abusive turn. According to the New York Times, Peter would often slap Steffi if she missed a shot or didn't complete a move to his liking. At the time, his violent actions weren't generally known, and outwardly Steffi maintained that her dad was an excellent coach, with her record of numerous wins and titles serving as some semblance of proof. But everything changed in 1997, when Peter was convicted of evading taxes on his daughter's income, owing about $7.4 million. Steffi cut off contact with her father, dropped him as a manager, and quit tennis altogether just 2 years later. Eventually, she reconciled with Papa Merciless, as her father had been nicknamed, and they were in regular contact when Peter died in 2013. Even by the particularly brutal standards of gymnastics, 1996 Olympic gold medalist Dominique Moceanu had a rough experience. The 14-year-old made history at the Atlanta Games when she became the youngest U.S. gymnast to ever win that top honor. According to an interview with NPR, however, she wasn't fully able to enjoy the moment, as she was worried that her domineering parents would be upset that she biffed both of her vault landings. Apparently, her fears were far from unfounded, as she claimed in the interview that her father had a history of being abusive, getting physical with her when he felt she wasn't training hard enough or had put on weight, even in front of other people. 2 years after the Olympic Games, Moceanu filed for emancipation. Shortly after that, she sued her parents for mismanaging her earnings and then filed for a restraining order when they, angered by her bid for independence, began following and threatening her. Things undoubtedly got even more complicated between the family members when, in the early 2000s, Moceanu discovered she had a younger sister who had been born without legs that her parents had never told her about.
I had to, confront my mom and dad and say, look, is this true? Did you give up a baby girl for adoption in 1987?
Her father died in 2008 after he and his daughter had reconciled. Legendary boxer Roy Jones Jr. is the oldest of five kids and the family's only son, so his father, Roy Jones Sr., pinned all of his own unrealized athletic dreams on the youngster and began sparring with him when he was just 5 or 6. According to Jones Jr., his father was relentless, completely unforgiving, and not afraid to get physical, even going so far as to hit his young son with a plastic pipe when he missed a jab. Things were so intense that Jones Jr. admitted to Sports Illustrated that he'd considered killing himself just to get away from his dominating dad, saying, "After a while, I didn't care about getting hurt or dying. I was in pain. I was so scared of my father." For his part, Jones Sr. openly admitted to terrorizing his athletic son, telling the New York Times, "To be a kingpin takes being hard. I made him train under pressure. Any mistake, I was right there." Eventually, it all got to be too much, and by 1992, the boxer had fired his father as his coach and manager. As far as we can tell, the two men never reconciled. After Prince Fielder followed in his father's footsteps of playing Major League Baseball, it seemed the shared experience would only bring the elder Cecil and younger Prince even closer together. As it turns out, that couldn't have been farther from the truth. Despite having a close relationship for much of Prince's early life, things between the two Fielders began to unravel in 2004, when Prince's parents began their divorce proceedings. In the process, it was revealed that the family was struggling financially and had a number of creditors chasing them down for large sums of money. The in-court fighting over who was at fault for the family's predicament got ugly, and Prince took his mother's side, accusing his dad of a gambling addiction. Things took an even uglier turn when Prince accused Cecil of taking $200,000 from his signing bonus without permission. The pair's relationship was so strained that Prince once told the Detroit News that his father was dead to him. It took a long time for the two men to work things out, but in 2015, when Prince retired, he was on speaking terms with his dad once again. Dennis Rodman was one of the most dominant power forwards in NBA history, but despite his incredible on-the-court talent, Dennis was perhaps even more well-known for his off-the-court antics.
To get the most out of him on the court, you had to give him some rope. And they gave him a lot of rope.
Many folks attribute his wild behavior to his troubled childhood. Dennis was raised by a single mom in an impoverished neighborhood in Dallas after his father left when he was just 3. Dennis and his father, the aptly named Philander Rodman, essentially had no relationship after that, as the elder Rodman was too busy having an additional 29 children by 16 women. For 42 years, Dennis had zero contact with his father, but ESPN reported that they met up for 3 minutes at an exhibition game in the Philippines in 2012. Dennis's dislike for his father is well known. In his autobiography, Bad As I Wanna Be, Rodman wrote, "I just look at it like this. Some man brought me into this world. That doesn't mean I have a father." Manny Pacquiao has had an incredibly successful career, and his wildly successful stats have led him to be widely regarded as one of the best small boxers of all time. But all of his success may not have happened if he hadn't had such a horrible father. Pacquiao grew up dirt poor in the Philippines, with two parents who weren't all that concerned with his well-being. Craving affection, the youngster adopted a stray dog that would become his constant, loving companion. According to the prize fighter, his father came home drunk late one night, got angry with his juvenile son, and then killed and ate his pet. The next day, Pacquiao left home, running away to Manila, where he'd discover his love of boxing. In his autobiography, Pacquiao wrote of the incident, "To a young boy, that was unforgivable. It was stealing something that I loved, which is far more terrible than stealing money." His father denied these vile actions, but there was undoubtedly a wedge between the pair. And for years, Pacquiao had nothing to do with his dad. Eventually, the men reconciled, and Rosalio Pacquiao was even spotted ringside at a number of the boxer's later fights. If you or someone you know is struggling with mental health, please contact the Crisis Text Line by texting HOME to 741-741 or call the National Alliance on Mental Illness Helpline at 1-800-950-NAMI 6264 or visit the National Institute of Mental Health website.